Okay, Matt. Yeah, welcome to the movie podium. We're doing our top three animated movies. I am your host, Matt. No, Matt's down there. I'm your host, Eric Merrow. Matt Scott of the movie podium. Why don't you tell me your top three animated movies? In order from three to one.
Why, thank you, Eric.
You're
I would
welcome.
Love to give you mine.
That's so polite.
So, my number three is the G.I. Joe movie from 1987.
Fucking of course it is.
Yeah, Cody's going to be real happy. Actually, Cody might be mad. That might be too low for Cody.
Fair. Yeah. I think it offers a perfect blend of action, adventure, and sci-fi elements that provide a captivating story. You have multiple intriguing storylines. You have the broadcast energy transmitter, or the BET, which still feels like a relevant weapon today. You have Falcon, Lieutenant Falcon, assigned to be retrained by Sergeant Slaughter.
You're going to war till you wish you were dead, and then keep going, because you're afraid if you don't, I won't let you die.
And he's teamed up with all the new goofy-ass recruits while all the like badass G.I. Joes are out getting their asses kicked and they're stuck in certain spots. And so Falcon's basically has to go and team up with all the goofballs. You have my favorite storyline, which is the redemption story of Cobra Commander. So Cobra Commander is turned into a snake by his own group. He ends up getting back at Globulus, who is the main bad guy, and Serpentor by leading the G.I. Joe team to the Cobra Law's lair and ultimately to their demise. So some of my favorite things about this movie are that there's some pretty stunning battle sequences. The animation still holds up. I actually went and saw this in theaters about a year ago, but this really still kicked ass in the theaters. Like, I was so stoked on it.
Nice.
So you have Chris Latta as Cobra Commander. I mean, I don't know if you've heard Cobra Commander. Daniel has, I'm sure, but his like high pitched voice that kind of gives that.
Oh, brah!
Yeah, but, right.
This may be an assassination attempt. Serpentor must stay here. We will intercept the intruder.
The like snake vibes.
I would like to ask you watching, please subscribe to the channel. We do more of these podium moments infrequently, but you know, there's a whole bunch. You can get clips here. You can watch our full episodes. You can also find us on Instagram, wherever you see your pod or wherever you get your podcasts. Matt, back to you. Please continue. I so rudely interrupted you.
No, thank you for adding that stuff there.
You're very welcome.
Yes. So I just like the voice acting. I like Don Johnson as Falcon. Sergeant Slaughter is in this as himself. It just kind of lands from its entertainment value. It's very engaging. There's a lot of cool battle scenes, like I mentioned. And there's just fond memories of growing up with the G.I. Joes in this movie.
Yeah. I remember the TV show I think they had.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was badass, too.
Yeah, because this was a thing in the 80s. Transformers did the same thing. They had a big movie,
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
1985, I believe.
Yeah, right before this. And that movie kicks ass, too.
Yes, it does.
The soundtrack in that movie is awesome.
It's my honorable mention. It has Stan Bush's nice. The Touch.
You've got the
yeah.
touch.
Yeah, that's a
is
good
that,
song.
Is that Matt's
You've
number
got
two?
The power.
It's not. I tried to mix it up kind of like you guys. So I didn't have all nostalgic or I didn't have all Disney.
Yeah.
I tried to keep it kind of mixed up.
Good call.
So my number two is Beavis and Butthead Do America.
Yes. Yes.
So Mike Judge rarely misses. And per usual, he nails this one with his typical humor, with a blend of satire and social commentary, subtly poking fun at the absurdity of American pop culture and society in the 90s. So I am more of a Mike Judge guy than Matt Stone and Trey Parker, not by much.
Me too.
But I just side with, you know, I mean, King of the Hill is the go-to, But Beavis and Butthead subtly kills it, and this movie is so good. There's so many quotes in this that are so juvenile that, like, they still make me laugh. You know, like, they're so, like, the reason they're juvenile, like, I got a beer. Hey, baby, I got a beer. Is this a goddamn?
I just have a question. Is this a goddamn? Goddamn, you know.
Like, those lines are so clever, but so dumb. Like, his humor is perfect. Is this a goddamn?
It's
like,
so stupid.
But then there's the clever bits like the butt nachos, which is just kind of a parody of how some advertising and marketing can easily manipulate its impressionable consumers. So you have my judge thinking of that social commentary underlying with these two idiots. It's such a perfect marriage. So it lands on my list because even though I first found this when I was 10 and thought it was funny, I still find it just as funny as a 35-year-old and really the same parts. Like sometimes when you get older, you're like, oh, I laugh at this part. No, I still laugh at, hey, baby, I got a beer.
I got a beer. Want some?
Like... That doesn't go away. There's just certain lines that are just like ingrained in you. And that's kind of like the, don't bring me here anymore, all right?
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Those kind of lines just stick with me. And this movie hit like that. So, yeah.
That's
kudos to Mike Judge for
that's a good one.
Killing it.
That's really fucking good.
I've never seen that movie, but I know the line, hey, baby, shit. I got beer.
Oh, man. I got a beer. Because they're
got a beer.
They're in the airplane, and he's just trying to hit on the stewardess who obviously has the beer, or any of the like slut slot mix ups. Yeah. Those are all good. Hey, there's a lot of sluts here.
Hey, Matt, that and was that number two.
Yeah. Yep.
What's number one?
So that leads me to my number one, which might not come as a surprise to any of you or if you know me well enough, but my number one is, of course, The Little Mermaid.
That's good. Yep.
I've seen that
one.
Hey.
I didn't guess it, but now that you said it, I'm like, oh, yeah. Yep.
That makes sense. Daniel, you probably would have guessed that.
I would have guessed that. I would have probably guessed that one or Beauty and the Beast, one of the two.
Yeah, yeah, that era. So I actually tried. Yeah. I watched Aladdin to see if it would make the list. Not to supplant.
The Will Smith version you're talking about.
You go to hell.
I've actually seen that one.
Oh my god, Kevin, you fucking
I haven't.
Suck.
I chose The Little Mermaid because there's so many aspects of this movie that I enjoy and appreciate, and I just couldn't think to choose anything else. There's so many good themes that I really like the self-sacrifice, the self-discovery, and of course, teen rebellion, that I just kind of are all things that I appreciate. I think it's still relatable in today's youth, and it was kind of the beginning of this Disney renaissance. So shortly after that, you had, you know, Beauty and the Beast, you had Aladdin, you had Lion King, Pocahontas, Mulan. This kind of kicked that off. I mean, there were some good movies in the 80s, like Fox and the Hound, but this had a grander feel to it.
Love to explore that shore up
above. Right? More vibrant colors, more ensemble songs. Just there was more brought to the table. Most cartoons or most Disney movies before this only had like one or two bangers. So like, you know, Cinderella might have one, or Fox and the Hound has like a half a song when they're talking about being friends. There's not a lot of Disney movies that have more than one or two big hits, but this one had three juggernauts. So you had the ultimate love song and Kiss the Girl.
Sing with me now.
You had the vibrant, yeah, I love how they bring that all together, and you have the wow, 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 and the bass, and the winds, and the words, you know, like, all that kind of flows.
Percussion,
strings, winds, words.
You have the fun sing-along in Under the Sea.
Under the sea, under the sea. Darling, it's better down where it's wetter. Take it from me.
And my personal favorite is Ariel's soul-searching power ballad, Part of Your World.
What would I give if I could live out of these waters?
Yeah.
I love that scene. That song's so catchy. For some reason, I always sung that song as a kid. You also had some less known or less mentioned, the Les Poissons, hee hee hee, ha ha ha.
Les Poissons, Les Poissons, hee hee hee, ha ha ha.
You had Poor Unfortunate Souls.
This poor unfortunate soul.
So there are so many good songs, so I love the soundtrack. And it's just, you have the lovable side characters like Sebastian Flounder. And again, the protagonist is equally charming, yet strong-willed, and not just another Disney princess. Yep. So... yeah. I just think that she embodies everything that you want in a protagonist, and Disney kind of nails it. And it's funny because before this, most of the Prince Charmings of the world had like no lines. And so Prince Eric kind of had more lines than any of those other princes. And while he still kind of has the best personality for a prince, he still has a lot more than, you know, Prince Charming or any of those others from like Cinderella.
Gee, you must have really been through something.
Those don't have really any dialogue, any lines. So this kind of introduces that concept as well. So I just think there's a lot here to digest, and it's such a good, fun movie.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So that's my
Yeah, opinion. It's got a lot of bangers.
This app right here in my background is named Ariel. It's red, and it's got the emblem of a mermaid on the front, and that it says Ariel.
That's
right
awesome.
There where I'm pointing.
Oh, I'll trade you.
No, it's okay. I want to keep it.
That's awesome. So that's my list.
Heck yeah. Thank you for that, and thank you for watching. Again, subscribe, and we'll see you later.
Please.
Bye!